by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing and hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine.
All right. Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for another week of Community Church of Edwardsburg, our online worship experience. Wherever you're joining us from, you are so very welcome. And we hope that you are staying connected, that you're staying connected to God, to each other, and to your purpose. Lots of ways you can do that through the church website, through our Facebook page, through a weekly podcast, through the weekly newsletter that goes out. Please, please stay connected to one another and to God and to your purpose. And today's going to look a little different than normal. We're going to have actually four different conversations. Now, some of these conversations have been planned for a while, but a couple of them have really been planned just for a couple days or a couple weeks because they're in response to really what's going on around us. So in a minute, we're going to start and we're going to have a conversation about our student ministry, our middle school and high school ministry, and we're going to specifically honor our high school graduating seniors. So that's one of the conversations that has been planned for a while. And then we're going to sing together. We're going to worship through music, and then we're also going to have a conversation about kids ministry. And so those are the conversations that have been planned for a while. But then after that, we're going to have a conversation about race, about justice, and that obviously is one that is kind of new in the last couple weeks that's come on the national spotlight. And so we're going to talk about that. And then we're going to end our time together with a conversation about mental health and mental illness and how the current COVID-19 crisis has contributed to that. So stay with us, and hopefully it will be encouraging. It will be hope-filled as we have these different conversations. We also want to let you know that we are getting closer to reopening in-person gatherings. So stay tuned for more information. But kind of the highlights are on Sunday, July 5th and Sunday, July 12th, we will be meeting for an outdoor service those days at the Edwardsburg Sports Complex. And then on July 19th, we will be back in the building. So we'll be here. We'll have two services, but that'll be on July 19th. So stay tuned for more specifics, kind of more procedures and protocols. But July 5th, July 12th, outdoor at the sports complex, July 19th, in the building with two services. And the last thing I want to say before we head into our student ministry conversation, honoring our graduates, just want to thank you again for faithfully supporting our ministry. And we invite you to, again, do that today from your home. You can give online at edwardsburg.church. You can also give through the Easy Tithe app. And so thank you for supporting as we continue this online ministry and also invest in what it's going to look like coming back together. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So, ready for our first conversation? Here we go. I'm going to invite Josh Galvin up to the stage with me. And Josh has served for about 4 years now as our student ministries director. He oversees all of our middle school and high school ministry that we do. And so, Josh, for those who are watching today that don't know you, tell us a little bit about yourself, your family, what you do when you're not here doing student ministry stuff so they can get to know you a little bit.
Sure. So I have a wife and I have three kids. My oldest is 4, my son is 2, and then my youngest daughter, she is 10 months old. She's just learning how to like crawl and stuff, which has been fun. As far as what I do when I'm not here, I am a teacher. I teach PE for 7th, 8th, and 9th grade students at Countryside Academy. And I've really enjoyed that. I basically get to play games every day with my students. Nice. Then the ones that I really like, I bring back to youth group and we play them here. So, I enjoy that and enjoy doing that with my students.
Good. Awesome. Awesome. We appreciate you guys. And so, for student ministry, for middle school, high school, that obviously has looked a lot different the last couple months. We haven't been able to gather in person. So what has that looked like? What has our student ministry looked like during this kind of stay at home time?
Yeah, so we've been doing a couple things. One, we've been kind of posting on social media and giving you guys some ideas or maybe some competitions and stuff with our students. We have also been doing a Sunday Night Live where you and I have been getting on, and actually Daniel Brown, have been getting on each Sunday and playing all sorts of crazy games, having some time from the Word. We've done some crazy stuff from learning TikTok dances to...
Dance is a little generous of a word. More like moving appendages.
Yeah, I mean, we attempted to do the TikTok dance. It was
uncoordinated. Better than me, so,
I doubt that. I doubt that. Yeah. We've been doing all sorts of stuff from eating hot sauces to then trying to speak afterwards. That was a mistake. Lots of fun games.
Yeah, so really trying to help the kids stay connected online while they've been apart. And so tonight at 6 o'clock is the last one kind of for this school year. So you can join us on Facebook, our church's youth group's Facebook page, Community Student Ministries, or our Community Student Ministries Instagram page tonight at 6 o'clock. And Josh and Daniel will actually be going live there tonight. So that's the final one kind of for this session. So looking forward to end of summer, beginning of fall, when we can maybe start to get together in a little bit bigger groups. What are you most excited about for our student ministry?
So I would say the big thing I'm excited about is when we can finally get back together. We have lots of little parts of a plan, but soon will be a whole plan of us getting together and having like a big, large event that will last most of a day and probably all night long. We have different plans on different locations and things that we're going to go to, but I'm pretty excited about that. Hopefully we can tire you out so that I can actually get some sleep at night, but who knows?
Who knows?
Teens don't like to sleep, so you guys might stay up all night.
Yeah, that's great. And then hopefully getting back to somewhat of a regular youth group weekly meeting and things like that. So great. So that's just a little highlight of what's been happening, what is coming. And now we are going to honor our 2020 graduates. There's actually 5 this year graduating from our youth group. And we're going to take a few minutes and honor each one of them. You know, they can't be here in person today. Typically they would be. But we want to congratulate you and tell you how proud we are of you and say some nice things about you. So, Josh, we're going to let you start with Daniel.
Yeah, so our first senior today is Daniel. His parents are Craig and Betsy. He has brothers Nate, Samuel, and Isaac. He graduated from Elkhart Memorial and will be attending IUSB. We asked him what his life verse was, and he said, "Let no one despise you for your youth, but set the believers as an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity." It's actually a great verse for Daniel. He has been a tremendous leader in our youth group, even as a teen. He has helped on our leadership team in the youth group with just, you know, coming alongside some of the younger kids in our youth group. He has also been a huge asset in my small group in helping facilitate conversations and discussions. Even down to he's coming in and doing Sunday Night Lives with us and being willing to put up with the crazy things I'm asking him to do on that. Daniel also loves running and playing other sports, but as I've known him, he's probably the most in shape person that I've known in a long part of my life. So he loves that.
That's great. Yep. All right, congrats, Daniel. Moving on to Bryce Blue. Bryce is a graduate of Edwardsburg High School. Parents Mike and Shelley Blue. He has an older sister, Reagan. And I love this major. He is going to study aerospace engineering. Great for a smart kid like Bryce. Study aerospace engineering at Western Michigan University. The verse he shared, Jeremiah 29:11, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future." So I got to know Bryce best. I was his basketball coach a couple years ago. Super hard worker, great kid, super athletic, and I really enjoyed having him on my basketball team. And got to know his family. His parents have been in our small group, so we've really got to know his family pretty well the last few years. And Bryce is a really kind young man. He was one of the favorite babysitters we had for our small group. My kids loved having Bryce as their babysitter because he'd play with them, he'd get down their level, and super kind kid. So Bryce, we're proud of you. Congratulations and best wishes at Western Michigan.
All right, our next senior is Hunter Ferguson. His parents are John and Elsie. He has siblings Jess, Alex, and Ethan. Hunter attended Edwardsburg and will be going for missionary aviation in Grand Rapids, which is pretty cool that he wants to go and fly planes and stuff as a missionary. So Hunter was part of my small group, and during youth group, he's always been willing to kind of jump in and do whatever activity we do. I know we did like a messy game night earlier this year, and he was more than willing to jump in and play those games. I never really had to force him or anything like that. He also is great at inviting people to our youth group. There was very few times at our youth group where he hadn't invited somebody to come and join us that week, and that was something I was always super proud of him for, was doing that, because that's an ability that I don't really have, and he is very, very good at it.
Yeah, so, that's great. Yeah. That's great. All right, congrats, Hunter. Next, we have Jack Lehman. Jack is also a graduate of Edwardsburg High School. Parents, Tim and Kimra, younger brother, Will, younger sister, Grace. And Jack is planning on attending Butler University this fall. Another really smart kid with a biology major on a pre-med track. So excited to see what Jack has there for his future. The verse he shared, Psalm 23:4, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me." I also got to know Jack fairly well, coaching him in basketball. One of the hardest workers that I've ever met, one of the best leaders as a young person that I've ever met. He was super encouraging. Whatever he put his mind to, athletically, physically, socially, academically, like he'd set goals and he'd accomplish it. He became an all-state runner and also just a really kind young man as well. One of my kids would run cross country, and Jack, being kind of the high school sports all-state hero, he'd send my kids an encouraging text the day of a big race and say, "Hey, you got this. You can do this." So very selfless. Couldn't be prouder of Jack. And so congratulations, Jack, and best wishes in Butler in the fall. And last but not least.
Yeah, our last senior is Mary Simons. She has parents Mike and Cheryl and siblings Selena and Anna. She graduated from Edwardsburg. Some of the things about Mary is she went to Guatemala this summer and showed her awesome ability to serve there. And one of the ways I got to see it in person was when we went to SOS the last few summers. She was huge in helping just serve in any way that we really asked her to. And if you don't know SOS, it's Summer of Service, and that's basically an opportunity we have as a youth group to serve the community, and she was always willing to help out and a great helper at that. And just some of the character traits that I've really seen in Mary is that she's a tremendously hard worker and has great perseverance even through some tougher things. So
And she has the cutest pet on her picture. She
that's true.
So well done, Mary. She is great. If you need a dog watcher, hire Mary. She does a great job, too. So there you go. So, that's our student ministry. Congratulations to all our seniors. We couldn't be more proud of you. And best wishes for what's next in your lives. We're going to sing a couple songs together now. So we're going to worship, turn our focus to God the Father and His love for us. And then when the songs are finished, we pre-recorded an interview earlier this week with Marissa Miscavige, our community kids director. And so you'll hear from her after the songs are done. But join us as we sing.
Made me new, now life begins with you. Yes, we're free, free forever, amen. When death was arrested in my life, began. Oh, we're free, free forever, we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free forever, amen. When death was arrested in my with a melody, you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone, and I'm no longer I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Your love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. Child. 'cause I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
All right, well, hello everyone. I am here with Marissa Miskevich. She is our Community Kids Director here at Community Church in Edwardsburg. And while we've been apart for the last few months and for a few more weeks, we thought we would bring her on for a quick interview and let you know a little bit more about her, her family, and also about what is going on with our Community Kids Ministry. So Marissa is in charge of everything from birth up through fifth grade. That's kind of her main areas that she serves here. But why don't we start with this, Marissa? Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, your family, any hobbies you might have, just so that people, for the few people out there that don't know you, just tell us about yourself a little bit.
Sure. So my husband, Jim, and I have been married for 14 years, actually, just the end of May here. And we have two kids in elementary, Tate and Claire. They just finished first grade and fourth grade. And then we, as a family, really like to play games together, and we like to go on bike rides. So during the summer, we spend a lot of time outdoors on our bikes. And then one of my hobbies is I really love to read, so lots of different books.
So how many books did you read last year? Do you remember?
Last year? I didn't keep a count.
Well, 2 years ago, you had a really good number. Do you remember what that was?
I think it was like 50.
50. But, that's impressive.
So mainly fiction, but some nonfiction.
And if you're on Facebook, they do some serious puzzle work too, right? They make some.
Yes, we have been lately. Now that we can go outside, less puzzles happening. Yeah. But
cool. Yeah. Cool. And then, okay, so you've worked with kids here at the church for how long now has it been?
So I think I've been the children's director here for 5 years now.
Okay, and before that, what did you, a little bit of education experience before you even
so
here?
Before that, I attended Indiana Wesleyan University and received a degree in elementary education and spent about 3.5 years teaching in Mishawaka before our kids were born, and then I stayed home with them. And then the last couple of years, since they've both been in school, I've been able to substitute, teach a little bit, and mainly their building. So that's been good, too.
Cool. And in addition to kids ministry, Marissa always also helps out with rent checks, paying bills here at the church, also handles our social media account. So she wears a lot of different hats. But kids ministry here, we call Community Kids, like I said, birth through fifth grade, you know, has looked a little different the last few months. But why don't you tell us, pre-COVID-19, what did a typical Kids Sunday or Kids Week look like before coronavirus was here?
Okay, so we have kids rooms for nursery up through fifth grade. So we would open our rooms at about 10:30 and have a time for connecting, playing some games, hanging out with each other, and getting to know leaders. And then each, not really nursery, but every other group has a Bible lesson. And usually some kind of video content, some kind of activities to, you know, extend learning about the lesson. And then they always had a gym time. And if it was outside, if it was nice, we could get outside sometimes.
Nice. And then a small group at the end, usually, especially for the older ones, that we kind of view that as important. And so that was kind of before. Every week the kids would have their own classroom based on their grades. It was really great experience. You know, my kids love doing that. And then in March, all of that kind of came to a halt, but we've still tried to provide resources for kids. So last few months, what has, during this stay-at-home quarantine time, what has our church offered for kids during this time?
So during this time, we've utilized a different curriculum, but we've had video content on our website as well as posted in our Facebook group for our parents to use. I know it's been a really busy time with all the e-learning and everything that's happening, so kind of to use whenever you're able. And then we also just have put a lot of other resources and activity ideas on our Facebook page in our group.
Yeah, that's been great. Some Zoom calls too. I know you've done that too.
Some Zoom.
And the other day, one of my kids, I won't tell you which one in case they're watching, But one of my kids was on the phone or an iPad, and I was kind of like, what are you doing? And she's like, I'm watching the kids' lesson from church. I'm like, oh, good decision. You know, so thanks for putting that out there. Appreciate that. And then as we look forward to the future, now we don't know exactly what it's going to look like or all the hows and the whens, but I know you have, and our leadership team at church has really been preparing and planning for what the future of church is going to look like and even kids' ministry. So when we get to the fall and begin some sort of reopening, what are some things you're looking forward to? What are some things you're excited about? But post-COVID-19, what do you think kids' ministry will look like?
So hopefully we'll be able to come back and it'll look pretty similar to what we've done before, where you know, we've got that opportunity to connect with leaders and connect with other kids. And grow kids in their love of Jesus, but our plan is that there'll be two services, so more opportunities for that to happen.
Yeah, that's great, that's great. And even, you know, one of the things I'm excited about, two services obviously is going to be more space for growth for new people to attend, but also there's a chance right now in kids ministry, most kids would see their teacher once a month. There's the opportunity that maybe they'd have a more even consistent adult presence. Maybe that adult could serve two or three or even four times a month, and that even impacts that relationship in that small group. So,
yeah,
excited about that. Well, thanks for joining us. Anything else you want to say?
No, we're good.
All right, well, that is everything you need to know about Marissa and a little bit about Jim, a little bit about our kids, but also about Community Kids here. So thank you for joining us. All right, well, hello, everyone. I am here with Marissa Miscavige. She is...
The video kept playing there. So I hope you're ready for the next conversation. You know, the student and kids conversations.
Oh, got to turn my microphone on.
All right, now we're ready. This is the danger of going live. The person in charge forgets to turn on his microphone. So that was all me. Thank you for your patience. Thanks for not leaving us, staying with us. But I hope you're ready for our next conversation. We had a conversation about students, we had a conversation about kids, and now we're really glad to have Linda here with us. Her and her family have been part of our church for several years, and you know, just in the last couple weeks with the death of George Floyd and everything that has kind of been happening since that, we felt as a church we wanted to speak into that situation, knowing that we don't have all the answers, we don't know all the right things to say, but we felt like we needed to say something, and Linda... She's a great person. She's a volunteer in our kids' ministry, in our student ministries. We love her. We love her family. And she has some great experiences that she can share with us today that we can learn from, to kind of speak some hope into what's going on in our nation and in our local communities and even around the world. And so, but I thought we would start with the story of how you accidentally started coming to this church. So why don't you tell us that story? It's kind of funny, but it's a great story. So go ahead.
Well, first of all, I'd like to say there's nothing such as an accident with God.
Yes, good.
So my family and I had been praying for God to just lead us to where he wanted us to be. So a friend of mine invited us to a church, and all she said was, the church is in Edwardsburg, down the road. And okay, we're like, oh, okay. She never mentioned the name of the church. So we came down Sunday morning and walked in, and we asked for her. And it seemed like, I think we met Marissa, and Marissa didn't know her. We asked for her son, and she didn't know her too. But the first thing we noticed when we walked in was just... that we were just welcomed and we just could feel the love. And we proceeded and came in to the sanctuary. And my middle child went on to the fifth grade class at the time. So we walked into church, and when we were sat down, we looked around for our friends and couldn't see them. And I whispered to my oldest daughter, Nombusa, and I said, I think we're in the wrong church. So we laughed about it. And after church, my youngest daughter came to me and she said to me, Mom, I have never begged you to take me to church, but please bring me back here.
Oh, that's great.
So ever since, we've been here.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. We love it. And yeah. So thanks for sharing us a little about yourself, how you ended up at this church, not really accidentally, but mm-hmm. God knew all along, and mm-hmm. thanks for jumping right in and getting involved in service. And you had a couple stories that you wanted to share with us in relation to, race and race relations and mm-hmm. things like that, and I think we can all learn from your story. So why don't you just go ahead and jump in with the first story there.
So when my daughter Nambuso was in first grade, she came home one day and she told me, she said, "Mom, nobody wants to sit with me during lunch." So it just broke my heart. And I decided to reach out to the teacher and to talk to her. So she told me that she hadn't noticed anything. So then she told me, she said, "Okay, I'll pay more attention." So later on, Nombuso had started to make friends, and the kids were sitting with her, and she made one of our close friends.
Great. Yeah. So it just took you kind of speaking up for her, and
yes.
then the teacher just didn't notice
yes.
and kind of did some intentionality. Mm-hmm. That's great.
Yeah.
And then even something kind of similar happened with your mm-hmm. son, but even
yeah.
a little more direct. Mm-hmm. So share what happened with Patrick.
So Patrick was playing in the playground when he was in kindergarten, and he told me, he said, one of the kids said to him, "I don't like brown."
Mm.
Yeah. Mm. So, as a parent, you just feel, it just breaks your heart to hear that. So I went back to the teacher, and I confronted her, and she told me, she said, "Oh, no, that's not acceptable." So she talked to the kids, and she told them that all of us are different, all different shades, just like my dress,
really close.
But beautiful in God's eyes, all made in his creation.
Yeah.
And now, as we speak, the boy actually begs for my son to go to his house to play.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
So they're almost like best friends. So it was kind of like an educational mm-hmm. thing for the boy to realize mm-hmm. that, hey, we're all equal. Mm-hmm. We're all the same.
We're
I'm not better.
Same.
We're just different.
Just different.
And different is okay. It's
yeah.
not It's not right or wrong.
Mm-hmm.
That's great. That's
yeah.
great. And so I appreciate you kind of mm-hmm. standing up for your kids, too.
Mm-hmm.
And then was there one more story about some neighbors as well? Did you want to tell that story?
Well, when we moved to a neighborhood,
yeah.
I think our neighbors were afraid to approach us.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the mom to the lady, approached us, and she said, she approached us and said hi, and the kids were able to meet each other. Then she told her daughter, she said, "How come you didn't tell me that your neighbors have kids?" So right now, as I speak, the neighbors actually moved from where we used to live and have followed us.
Oh,
the
wow.
Boys are just best friends.
Oh, that's great. That's great. Well,
yeah.
I appreciate you sharing those stories. Mm-hmm. So speak to the people out here who, if you could say anything to them, mm-hmm. maybe they're nervous about what to do or about mm-hmm. approaching someone. What lessons have you learned from your life experience, but mm-hmm. specifically from those three stories, what lessons have you learned or what lessons could you tell us about kind of how to handle, mm-hmm. navigate what we're going through right now?
Firstly, don't be afraid to approach people who are different from you,
mm.
whether it's with race,
yeah.
whether they're special needs.
Yeah.
Just try and reach out. And also, I think as parents, we need to teach our children that we may be different. And especially as Christians,
yeah.
we need to share the love of God regardless
yeah.
of where the person is from, how they look. We are to emulate Jesus,
mm-hmm.
and he loved every one of us.
Yeah. Yeah, that's great. And so a couple of things that I've heard this week and kind of heard through your story, you know, the importance mm-hmm. of listening to mm-hmm. others, the importance of education, of learning about mm-hmm. things or people that are different. And I think something you said earlier, and we were talking before this,
mm-hmm.
You talked about proximity. Sometimes mm-hmm. when you get closer to something, like maybe it's not as different as it seemed, or it's not scary anymore
exactly.
because you got close to it.
Exactly.
And even the idea of empathy as well has
mm-hmm.
come through. So,
mm-hmm.
and kind of the last thing, I know you wanted to mm-hmm. share some scripture with us.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is the foundation of everything we do here is based on that God loves the world,
mm-hmm.
every single person. And it's his love and the gift of his son, Jesus, that really, that we're made in his image, that is the equalizer. And so go ahead and share some of those scripture with us.
The first one is 1 John chapter 3, verse 18. Little children, let us not love with in word or talk, but in deed and in truth.
Mm. Yeah. So not just what we say, but with our actions.
With our actions. Yeah, let's follow it up.
Yeah. Yeah. That's good. Mm-hmm.
And the next one is Proverbs chapter 31, verse 8, out of the New Living Translation. Mm-hmm. Speak up for those who can't speak up for themselves. Ensure justice for those being crushed.
Mm. Thank you so much. Anything else you want to say before you go?
No.
You're good. And so thank you so much. One other resource that I want to mention, if you're like, hey, I want to learn more. I don't know what to do. I want to do more. This is a great resource. It's a book called Be the Bridge. It's actually an organization, kind of a movement, written by a Christian woman of color. Her name is Latasha Morrison. And the subtitle is Pursuing God's Heart for Racial Reconciliation. And she really comes at it from a unique perspective because she is a black woman. But she also has in her family, she has some military members in her family, and she also has some police officers in her family. So she's kind of hitting all these different aspects, and she blends it together so well and really talks about God's heart for reconciliation. So if you kind of want to know what a next step for you would be, I would encourage you to check this resource out. So we're going to say thank you, Linda, and let Linda leave the stage, and we're going to kind of get ready for our final conversation. And so I appreciate you staying with us. If you're like me, and you're kind of this single track mind that really struggles with multitasking, today might be a little haphazard for you. So do your best to stay with us. But we had our community discussion, we had our kids discussion, we just had a really, really important conversation that even with Linda, we just decided Friday and Saturday to have this conversation because it deals with the reality that we're dealing with. And the final conversation, which we've been talking about this for a few weeks and excited to have Kim and Tom join us, is to talk about mental health or mental illness and how that even looks a little different now that we are, that we've kind of been in this stay-at-home isolation thing for a couple months. So I'm going to set the stage of the conversation, then we'll let you guys introduce yourselves and define some terms for us. But pre-COVID-19, before the coronavirus pandemic, the National Alliance of Mental Illness, their research said that approximately 1 in 5 adults in the U.S., so 1 in 5 adults, almost 47 million adults, experience mental illness each year. And that was pre-COVID-19. The World Health Organization, their stats said that 1 in 4, or 25% of people worldwide, will experience a mental health issue each year. So what does it look like now? Now, it's hard to get really clear numbers, but talking with you guys and even doing some research with other people and online, it really seems like that there's significant and sustained symptoms of mental health issues, of mental illness, of depression, of anxiety that have been happening the last couple months because of this increased isolation. So here's our goal for today is, and these guys are going to talk about this, we want to reduce the stigma. We want to reduce the shame that a lot of times is associated with mental health, and we want to encourage people to seek help just like they would for any other illness. And we believe that the church should be leading the way in this, in rejecting the stigma, rejecting the irrational fears, rejecting the shame that a lot of time is associated with this. So that's the situation. We feel like it's on a rise because of what's been happening in the last few months and last few weeks, and we want to speak some truth and some health into that situation. So you guys are the experts or the professionals, and so why don't you start with Kim. Why don't you introduce yourself to our audience, tell us a little bit about yourself and your work in this area.
Husband and I, Damon Knowlton, we come to this church. You might have seen us around with our daughters, mainly Kelsey, who is a junior this year in Niles High School, and our daughter Daria, our oldest, is up at Grand Valley in Allendale. I am a school psychologist. I work with Barry and Risa, which is Regional Educational Service Agency. That is up in Berrien Springs. I've been a school psychologist with them for, this is my 31st year.
Oh, wow, that's great.
So quite a while. Working mostly with special needs students and special needs families, and a lot of that does deal with mental health.
Yeah, very good. Thank you for joining us. And Tom, a lot of you in the Edwardsburg, Michiana community would know Tom. He goes to a different church, so you may not know him in our church, but a great friend of our family, of our community. And so Tom, introduce yourself for us.
Thank you, James. My name's Tom Pebriza, and as James said, I'm actually a native of the community here. I attend Our Lady of the Lake Catholic Church, and for about the last 23 years, I've worked for Woodlands Behavioral Health Care, which is Cass County's community mental health center. Prior to that, I've worked for the former Madison Center, which is now Oaklawn Services, but I worked specifically out of the Center for the Homeless down in South Bend, where we had outreach for mental health clients down there.
That's great. So a lot of 30 years experience with each one of them in different arenas related to mental health, mental issues. So I've been saying that word. I've been saying the phrase mental health or mental illness, but we should probably define that, right? So Kim, why don't you go first? How would you define mental health or more specifically mental illness? How would you define that for us?
Well, I'll start with mental health. Mental health to me would mean it's a state of well-being where you are just able to effectively cope with life circumstances. Circumstances socially, emotionally, mentally, spiritually. And then when you're not able to, that would be mental illness, where your coping mechanisms, they break down, or sometimes they go into overdrive. So then you are not able to function and handle daily life.
Good. Anything you want to add to that?
In terms of mental health, I think Kim said it all. It's really a great encapsulation of what good mental health is. Yeah. In terms of mental illness, there are some segments that kind of happen. I work primarily with folks who have chronic and persistent mental illness. Okay. That would be familiar to most folks as bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, schizoaffective disorder. Mm-hmm. Those tend to be a little more physiologically based and require some more significant treatment. That also is segment of mental illness, I think that a lot of folks are familiar with.
Right. And so maybe even on the other end of the spectrum, you know, maybe some severe depression or anxiety or things like that could be mental health, or even some things that could lead up to suicide, that would all be under this arena, right?
Right.
Okay. So that's kind of defining it. And one of the things I know you guys really wanted to share were, you know, we talked about reducing the stigma or reducing the shame that's a lot of times culturally associated with mental illness. And one of the things that can help us do that is talking about some common myths. So we'll let you start with this one, Tom. But what are some common myths about mental illness that you would like to say, this is not true?
Right. Well, in terms of, I'll speak first more directly to kind of the folks that I work with on a day-to-day basis. A very common stigma is that folks with severe and persistent mental illness are dangerous.
Okay.
Statistics have borne out that on the population as a whole, they're less dangerous than those of us so-called healthy people. It's not to say that there isn't aberrations to that on both sides, but that's a real common stigma. And I think for me, another one, when we look at more at the depression and anxiety levels, is that I think people that experience that initially are going to feel like it might be a moral failing, it might be a personal inability, a personal weakness, and it tends to exacerbate those symptoms.
Got it. Yeah.
And they just need to know that that's not true.
Good.
It's not true.
Yeah.
It would be really rare if none of us ever experienced anxiety or depression in our lives.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. That I like what you said. That we all deal with this to one level or another.
Right.
Yeah, that's really good. Anything you want to add, Kim?
Probably one of the things I hear, if you're mentally ill, that means you're crazy. It does not mean you're crazy. Again, if we go back to what mental health is, it means you're able to cope with life. If you are mentally ill, that system has broken down in your mentality. So we just need to help somebody in that circumstance too. What can we do to help them function better? What can we do to help them build those coping mechanisms back up?
Yeah, good. All right, so we'll stay with you, Kim. So in your opinion, what is the current state of mental health, specifically related to the COVID-19 pandemic? Has it been the same? Have you seen a rise? What is the same or different kind of the last two and a half months?
I think personally, in terms of what I've seen in families, is it kind of depends on the family circumstances.
Okay.
If people have been able to, for instance, if parents have still been able to have an income, if they have supports to help with their kids, if there are children in the home, I think their level of mentality has stayed pretty good. Unfortunately, there are other circumstances where either parents have lost their jobs, they don't have family support, where then things have broken down. And I think nationally we've seen that a lot, where because we've been cooped up at home, because we have all these constraints, if there's a moment to try to get out and do things, sometimes, again, it's gone a little haywire.
Right.
We look at Lansing with some of the marches, things like that, even nowadays. I think we have to be really careful about trying to make sure we have supports.
Yeah, good, good. What would you like to add to that?
I would agree with Kim. I think on the whole, and even prior, I think, to the COVID-19, we're seeing an increase in just a generalized level of anxiety, levels of depression, certainly levels of substance use and abuse through our agency. And then add on to that the COVID and the pandemic, with people facing job loss, facing income loss, facing uncertainty. It's only continued to increase. There are also, I think, societal impacts, obviously, that were there prior to the whole pandemic.
Yeah, I think you're right.
That contribute.
So maybe this is even revealed. It's kind of peeled a layer back of what was already there. Even
I think that's a great analogy.
I think even before, you know, working with middle school and high school students, there's been a few larger churches that would survey their students and say, hey, what topics would you like us to cover in youth ministry? What are you really struggling with? And stress and anxiety were the top of the list for these middle school and high school students. So I think you're right in that. It was here before, and kind of the support's been peeled away for a lot of us. And so that can be a negative, but maybe it could also be a positive, where now we can deal with the reality of what's going on.
Exactly.
So let's talk about trying to offer people help, or let's say it this way. What are some best practices? If I want to improve my mental health, what are some best practices I could be doing, our listeners or viewers could be doing to improve their mental health? Let me start with you, Kim.
I'll just start with some practical ones. I think Tom can go into more of the, if you're on the next level of needing mental health. One is, which we've been saying it all along, decrease that screen time.
Yeah.
Even though it's fun and it's exciting and there's riveting stuff when you go onto social media, you got to limit yourself because you can be overwhelmed. another one that's a main focus that I've heard when I've been listening to articles and reading articles and things like that is you need to keep a routine. Even though, especially in this time of upheaval, keeping a schedule, keeping a routine, trying to have some sameness and stability in your life, that's going to help ground you. If all else is going kind of haywire, at least you know, okay, this is what my routine is going to be for the day. Even if that means getting out of your sleep PJs into your daytime PJs,
routine
like that, just changing clothes.
For one of my kids, he puts his pants over his PJs to walk the dog.
There you go. Yeah. And another thing is just getting outside, being in nature. There's more and more studies about just being in that green environment, in that natural environment.
Yeah.
Whether you're exercising, whether it's a leisurely stroll, get out in nature. That is very healthy for the system.
Yeah, I was reading something this week, and they said 15 minutes a day in the sun, or you know, or the pretend sun in Michigan sometime, but it's up there when we can't see it. No, that's great. Do you want to even talk maybe a bit more of the chronic stuff too, some best practices?
Sure. Some of the basic best practices, obviously, that our agency uses in terms of, say, more of a traditional therapy that you would understand would be CBT or cognitive behavioral therapy. That's a pretty basic one across the board, and what that entails is, you correct me if I'm wrong, you're probably more an expert on that, but is essentially kind of beginning to explore your thought patterns and change those and how you cognitively see things and where might that be leading you in a more negative way. For more severe and persistent issues, obviously, we offer psychiatric evaluation. And for a lot of folks, medication therapy is essential. Again, that's not a sign of moral weakness or an inability to deal with your problems. Sometimes that is essential.
I like what you said about the cognitive behavioral therapy. You know, in Romans, kind of the Bible lingo, it talks about renewing your mind. And that's kind of what it is. You're renewing your mind, you're changing your thought patterns, and that's great. So this kind of a piggyback into that, you both said, hey, here's some good practices to improve your mental health. Is there anything you kind of you kind of added to limit the screen time, but anything else we could be avoiding that could contribute to decreased mental health? Anything else you guys wanted to add to that?
I would say one of the things is not getting enough sleep.
Oh, okay. Yes. Yes.
Again, more and more studies are showing that people need sleep. Teenagers need even more sleep than like regular adults do.
Yeah.
8 to 9 hours a night. I'm horrible at this, so I'm not taking my own advice. But that is a huge thing you can do to make sure that you combat the depression, mental illness, feelings of anxiety, any of that.
Yeah.
Another thing is, don't overthink things and think, oh, now that I've got time off, I should be doing this, this, and this, and this.
Right, right.
Even though we have more time, James, it doesn't necessarily mean that emotionally we have the effort that we can put into things. So you may be, especially again, if you're overdoing on Facebook, things like that, you're seeing people, oh, I've done this, I'm baking this, I'm remodeling my home. And maybe you're thinking, oh, I'm not doing any of that.
Yeah.
It's okay. If your circumstances are that emotionally, or just without your family circumstances, you can't handle a big project, that's okay.
Yeah.
Just do what you need to do, do your routine, get things by, and take care of your kids and your family.
Yeah, so I think what I hear you saying is like, be gentle with yourself or give yourself some grace, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. You know, while we're giving you these best practices, don't be like, I gotta do all 10 of these right now. No, give yourself some grace, be gentle with yourself. I like that, good. Mm-hmm. Anything else to avoid, Tom?
I agree with that. I think, if there's one maybe positive that you can bring out of this pandemic is it's opened up a space, I think, for opportunity to maybe kind of enter some contemplation things.
Yeah.
It's a term we use in the Catholic Church.
Yeah,
maybe
yeah,
you guys use it too.
Yeah.
But some contemplative space.
Yes.
And I think that's just so vital and essential for us in any walk.
Yeah,
and we don't do that. I think that's, as Americans, I think we're probably more prone to that than other places.
Yeah, you're right.
It's
you're
always
right.
Accomplishment, goals.
Yeah.
You got to take a step back.
That's why we get all our best ideas in the shower, right?
Because
we have space to think, right?
Exactly.
We're on a walk. Yeah,
exactly.
Absolutely, absolutely. Right. Okay, as we kind of start to kind of wind things down here for this segment, as a follower of Jesus, what scripture could you share to offer hope, or encouragement to people who are wherever they are in this spectrum? They're depressed, they're anxious, you know, maybe they have some chronic things. Wherever they are on the pendulum, what would you say to them? Kind of some Bible support or encouragement.
The first thing to remember is just even though we're in some turbulent times, some unknown times, God is in control. We may not see why or how, but He is.
Yeah.
And my favorite verse, kind of goes along with that. It's Psalm 27. Mm-hmm. This is the King James version. Some trust in chariots, some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God.
Yeah.
That, again, God is in control.
Yeah, good, good. Go ahead, Tom.
Well, like a good Catholic, I can't quote you verse.
You're good. So, yeah. No, what you said was really good about Paul, right?
I think, for me, that's maybe one of the most profound truths in all of Scripture is Paul's admonition that when I'm weak, I'm strong.
Yes.
I think our human weakness and fallibility is really the leveling ground that we as a human race live on. And we forget that a lot of times because we think that our identity should be shown in success, achievement.
Mm-hmm.
And that takes us away from each other, I think, in a lot of ways. And I've learned that being around folks who live impoverished lives. I think that's one thing that they've given me so much is that human weakness is our human bonding agent.
Yeah.
It necessitates in us mercy, forgiveness,
absolutely.
Humility.
Yes. Yes. And really, I think what the last couple months for a lot of us is it took away the mirage that we had of control, right? We've never really been in control, but we've kind of felt like we have been.
Mm-hmm.
And when that was stripped away, hopefully it will lead us to a greater dependence on God, less on ourselves, feeling like, hey, I can't figure this out. I can't understand it all. I don't know what the next thing to do is. And so our brokenness, our sin, our weakness, you know, then we're not trusted in those chariots and those horses, like you said in Psalms, and we're remembering where our focus goes off of ourselves and it goes to God because we need Him. And that's good. I appreciate you sharing that. One final question for both of you. Maybe you can list a couple of these. If someone out there says, I want to learn more, maybe I need some help, I want to do some research, some education, who could they reach out to? And for those of you who are watching, the things they mentioned, even a few that they haven't mentioned, we will put that out there for you as a resource page so you can learn some more or reach out to someone if you need some help. But Tom, what about you? What are a couple places or resources people could look to for help in this area?
Online, our agency, if you go to woodlandsbehavioralhealth.org, .org, our website has many links. We also have a 24/7, 24-hour, 7 days a week crisis number.
Oh, great.
We have what we call a warm line, basically. So when you call, you go through a tree a little bit, but if you need to, you can be put in touch with a counseling service that will do some phone triage with you as to what's going on.
Great.
Also, and I think you mentioned it, National Alliance for the Mentally Ill, NAMI is their acronym. Their website is huge in terms of mental health resources. And also plenty of apps. I didn't mention mindfulness is a big thing today, and that's kind of goes back to that contemplation. And, there's tons of those. All you got to do is Google mindfulness, and you'll find
that's great. That's great. Yeah. What would you like to add, Kim?
So Woodlands would be for Cass County. I live in Berrien County. So Berrien County, the equivalent of that would be Riverwood Mental Health Center. They also have a 24-hour hotline, and they have a branch in Benton Harbor, their main branch, and they also have a branch in Niles. And you can go online, find their numbers or their website. I guess another thing for me is I am a podcast freak. I listen to podcasts literally daily. And there's a couple of them I find really helpful. One is called The Happiness Lab. And it just goes through, this is not from a Christian perspective, but it does go through in terms of things that we people think, oh, this is going to make me happy, getting a better job, doing this, doing that. It helps dispel those myths, and it helps give what we need on a daily basis. And another one is Savvy Psychologist. Mm-hmm. And then another one, if you're more interested in like the actual COVID stuff, there's one called Life's Little Mysteries, and every Friday they have kind of like a COVID roundup where they go through the research for the week and then question and answer time.
Good, good. And so they mentioned a couple Michigan locations. For those in Indiana, we have some people in our church that work at Oaklawn down in Elkhart and Goshen, kind of all over the place, and that's a great resource if you're kind of down in the Indiana area. And so like I mentioned before, we'll put that all out for you this week, and we really want you to get help if you need it. Just kind of a couple closing thoughts here as we kind of wrap our whole day of lots of different conversations up. I just want to share a couple scripture verses with you. The first one from Psalm 34:18. Really, I think here's a couple things I want to say. God sees you and is with you. So God sees you and is with you. And God is close to those who are suffering. All throughout the Bible, all throughout Scripture, God talks about how he's near or he's close. Here's what this verse says. It says, God is close to the brokenhearted. He rescues those whose spirits are crushed. So you might be listening today, and you might feel like your spirit is crushed. You can't breathe. You might feel like you're brokenhearted. Well, God says, hey, I'm especially close to you. And then in Psalm 145:18 says, the Lord is close to all who call on him. Yes, to all who call on him in truth. So, you know, I've been there. We don't know what else to do, and you just call out to God. God's like, hey, that's what I want. I want you to call out to me. I hear you. I'm close to you. And then Romans 8, I love this passage. It says, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray for, but the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. And the Father who knows all hearts knows what the Spirit is saying, for the Spirit pleads for us believers in harmony with God's own will. So you might be in a really dark or a deep place right now where you can't even like verbalize what's going on inside you. You don't have the words to say to a friend or to a counselor or even to God. Well, what God says here, it's like the Holy Spirit like makes sounds for you or makes these spiritual groanings, these words for you. It's almost like he translates the feelings that are in your heart and your soul that you can't put words to. He translates that to God the Father. So God sees you. God is with you. If you're suffering, God is close to those who are suffering. So kind of wrapping this all up, the struggle with mental illness, it shouldn't be a source of shame or something to be kept hidden. You know, the church, we want our church to be a place of safety and community where those who are struggling can be honest, where you can ask people to rally around you in prayer and support, and you can be assisted in seeking professional help. So we've talked about a lot today. We've talked about students and kids and race and mental illness. And I don't know about you, but maybe you've seen a post that says, I wish 2020 could be canceled. Like, it's just been a rough year. Or there's kind of a meme out there with the Back to Future crew where they're like, whatever you do, don't set the car to 2020, you know? But my wife shared this with me the other day, and I thought I'd kind of close with this before we pray. What if 2020 isn't canceled? What if 2020 isn't canceled? What if 2020 is the year we've been waiting for? A year so uncomfortable, so painful, so scary, so raw, that it finally forces us to grow. A year that screams so loud, finally awakening us from our ignorant slumber. A year we finally accept the need for change, declare change, work for change, become the change. A year we finally band together instead of pushing each other further apart. 2020 isn't canceled, but rather the most important year of them all. And that's by Leslie Dwight. So, you know, Tom mentioned this, that this current crisis has maybe revealed some things that we've been able to be open and honest about that we haven't been before. And God works in the openness, the honesty. God works in the brokenness. And hopefully you've been given some hope today. Hopefully you've been given some encouragement to keep learning, to keep growing. And really the foundation of everything is the gospel. It's the good news of how you and I can have a relationship with God by believing in Jesus' death and his resurrection in our place for our sins. So we invite you on that journey with us even today. So thank you so much, Kim. Thank you so much, Tom, for being with us. I'm going to close us in prayer, and then we're going to send you out this week to make 2020 better. Allow it to change you and grow you, make you better, the people around you better, really by sharing God's love, by loving God and loving others. So let's pray together. Father, you know, if we're being honest, sometimes the current situation around us can seem overwhelming and confusing, and it can just bring up a whole range of different emotions and feelings. And we bring that all to you today because, like we've said already today, you're in control, you're in charge, you're accomplishing your purposes, even if we can't see it or understand it. So we give it all to you, and we also claim our responsibility to maybe repent for some wrongdoings, maybe to educate ourselves, to learn some more, and also going forward to make good choices. And Father, if there's anybody watching or listening today that doesn't know you, we pray that you would speak to them clearly and that they would begin this relationship with you by believing in Jesus and his death and resurrection. So encourage those who need encouragement today, Father. Lift them up. Give them hope. Help them to believe for the first time. Help them to trust you again, wherever they are in their journey. Just help them to take that next step. And we are just so grateful that you love us, that you're with us through all this craziness going around. And we trust you, and we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.